Hey guys, welcome to all of you on our channel, that is Achieve IAS. So friends, as you know that on our channel we are targeting the exam of civil services, and for that purpose we have started multiple series on our channel that target your prelims as well as mains. So in this video we will be talking about a daily current affair MCQ series, in which what we do, we daily discuss MCQs from your current affair perspective. So today is 1st November 2019, so let's see what are the questions for today. So the first question is, consider the following statement. First, the developing country tag in WTO is based on self-selection, means a specific country can claim the tag on the basis of its level of development. Second, in case of least developing countries, the status is given as per the per capita income status of the UN. So we have to choose that which of the above statements are correct. So friends, answer is C, that is both these statements are correct. So developing country tag is based on self-selection. So, and next is, in case of least developing countries, the status is given as per the per capita income status of UN. So this question has been framed in the context of an article that appeared in The Hindu that discussed about developing nation status in WTO issue. So what system is followed by WTO? So WTO follows, it designates countries as developed, developing and least developed countries. So WTO agreement provides that LDC status of a country in the WTO is based on such status being recognized by the UN. So please notice, this is very important. So least developing country status to a country is provided is based on such status being recognized by UN, unless and until UN doesn't recognize this. So that country cannot become least developed country, but the agreement does not mention any criterion to determine a developing country status. So if there is developing country status, then there is no criteria for it. But if there is the criteria of least developing developed countries is to be given to a particular country, then this must be recognized by UN, that is United Nations. So General Agreement on Tariffs and Trade also recognizes that attaining the objectives of this agreement would require facilitating the progressing of development of those countries that can only support low levels of development are at the early stages of development. So more details you can check by pausing the video. Now let's move on to the next question. Next is D-Track, Ghost Cat, Pegasus method seen in news are related to A. Cryptocurrencies, B. Cyber attacks, C. Artificial intelligence, D. None of the above. So friends, the answer is B. Cyber attacks. So these malwares have been in news because of the recent revelation by WhatsApp that this malware is being used to spy on various activists and journalists in India as well as abroad. So NPCIL CL's Kudankulam Dynamic Power Station WhatsApp mobile platform or browsing platform have come under cyber attack. So malware named D-Track is a new spyware tool that is believed to be actively targeting a large number of Indian institutions in order to steal confidential data. So and as well as remotely downloading malicious tool, tracking key logs and monitoring IP internet protocol traffic. And then D-Track was originated in North Korea by the hackers group Lazarus. So attack revived the memories of Stuxnet virus attack on the Iranian nuclear facility in 2018. So acceptance of cyber attack in NPCIL system highlights the fact that nuclear reactors are not only prone to natural disasters but also to cyber attacks. So more details are here. So one ghost that recently caused some panic on the internet is Ghostcat 3PC. So the malware's goal is to hijack users' mobile browsing sessions. So infection begins when a user visits a particular website and is served a malicious advertisement. So Ghostcat fingerprints the browser to collect device information and eventually leads the user to malicious content. And then Pegasus and WhatsApp call voice call spyware is this is basically in WhatsApp. It allowed the access to access the phone's camera as well as microphone and collect location data. So software took advantage of a security hole in WhatsApp's while call function to carry out the attack. So the attackers could simply call the users to install the surveillance software, and this was successful even when the call was not taken, and at the times the call would even show up in the user's call log, thus the user would not know that their device had been compromised. Now let's move on to the next question. Next is, consider the following statements related to indigenous air independent propulsion. First, it is very important for the submarines to stay underwater for longer period of time and makes the submarine more stealthier. Second, DRDO has developed a fuel cell power powered AIP module technology that will make submarine to stay underwater for longer period. So we have to choose that which of the above statements is are correct. So both statements are correct. So this air independent propulsion, as is clear from its name, so it basically enhances the submarine's capability to stay for a longer period of time underwater. So it makes submarine more stealthier. So DRDO has recently developed a fuel cell powered air independent propulsion module technology, and answer is C. So context is basically indigenous air propulsion independent propulsion system to enhance the endurance of conventional submarines being developed by DRDO reached a milestone with the successful operation of a land-based prototype. So basically it is any air independent propulsion is any marine propulsion technology that allows a non-nuclear submarine to operate without access to atmospheric oxygen, because obviously submarines, if they remain underwater, so they have to come over water to take oxygen. But this air independent propulsion makes it possible so that the non-nuclear submarine can operate beneath the surface of water for longer time by surfacing or using a snorkel. By not using this technology. And then AIP can augment or replace the diesel electric propulsion system of non-nuclear vessels. So it enables conventional submarines to remain submerged for longer duration. So it has a force multiplier effect on the lethality of a diesel electric submarine, as it enhances the submerged endurance of the boat several folds. So all Scorpene submarines of the Navy are planned to be equipped with an AIP module in due course. Now let's move on to the next question. Next is, consider the following statements related to Tipu Sultan. First, he devised a land revenue system based on detailed surveys and classification in which the tax imposed directly tax was imposed directly on the peasant and collected through salaried agents in cash, widening the state's resource base. Second is, he commissioned state trading corporation on the lines of Europeans to set up factories. So friends, let me tell you that the answer is C. That is both 1 and 2. So this context is basically, recently the Karnataka chief minister has said that has dropped the hints that lessons on the Tipu Sultan would be dropped from state syllabus textbook, saying that the issue would be reviewed. So removal of Tipu from textbook will fundamentally alter the history of early modern India and make invisible one of the key individuals in the society and politics of South India in the second half of the 18th century. So you might be aware about the battles that were fought between Tipu Sultan and East India Company. So background is basically regarding he was the ruler of Mysore, and this is a controversy that is prevalent in Karnataka. So previously it was over the celebrations of his Jayanti, and over lessons related to him in the textbooks. So he was basically ruler of the kingdom of Mysore and the eldest son of the Sultan Haider Ali of Mysore. So in a wider national narrative, Tipu has so far been a man of imagination and courage, and a brilliant military strategist who in a short reign of 17 years mounted the most serious challenge the company faced in India. So contributions are, first Anglo-Mysore War, he fought against the Marathas in second Anglo-Mysore War. So he fought company forces 4 times, and he defeated them many times, 3 times, and lastly he was killed defending his capital Srirangapatnam in the 4th Anglo-Mysore War. So he reorganized his army along European lines and using new technology, including what is considered the first war rocket. So he also devised a new land revenue system and also modernized agriculture, gave tax breaks for developing wasteland, built irrigation infrastructure and repaired old dams, and promoted agricultural manufacturing and sericulture. So he also built a navy to support trade. So he commissioned also a state commercial corporation to set up factories. So controversies are basically, concerns are raised on nearly every historical figure. Perspectives differ. So Haider and Tipu had strong territorial ambitions and invaded and annexed territories outside Mysore. So also they burned down entire towns and villages while doing so. They razed hundreds of temples and churches and forcibly converted Hindus. So the historical report, Tipu Sultan boasting about, so the historical record is there that Tipu Sultan boasted about having forced infidels to convert to Islam and of having destroyed their places of worship. So the disagreement then is between who see the Tiger of Mysore as a bulwark against colonialism and a great son of Karnataka, and those who point to his destruction of temples and forced conversion of Hindus and Christians to accuse him of tyranny and fanaticism. Now let's move on to the next question. Next is, consider the following statements related to national pension scheme. First, any Indian citizen, resident or non-resident and OCIs are eligible to join national pension scheme till the age of 65 years. So the scheme is managed by Pension Fund Regulatory and Development Authority. So friends, both of these statements are correct. So Pension Fund Regulatory and Development Authority has now permitted overseas citizens of India to enroll for this national pension scheme. So at par with the non-resident Indians. So NPS scheme is basically a government sponsored pension scheme launched in January 2004. It's for government employees. However, in 2009 it was opened for to all sections. So it allowed the subscribers to contribute regularly in a pension account during their working life. So in retirement, subscribers can withdraw a part of the corpus in lump sum and use the remaining corpus to buy an annuity to secure a regular income after retirement. So the system is managed by PFRDA. So who can join? A citizen between the year of 18 to 65 years can join, and NRA can also join. However, the account will be closed if there is a change in the citizenship status of NRI, and also now any Indian citizen, resident or non-resident, and OCIs are eligible to join NPS till the age of 65 years. Next is, International Solar Alliance is headquartered in. It is quite easy answer. So a question answer is C. So basically, recently India is hosting second assembly of International Solar Alliance. So Ministry of New and Renewable Energy is hosting the event. So it is the highest decision-making body, that is the International Solar Alliance Assembly. So it gives directions on financial and administrative issues. So more details you can check by pausing the video. So it is basically headquartered in Gurugram, at Gurugram, India. Now let's move on to the next question. Next is, NIRVIC scheme seen in news is related to A, boosting export, B, boosting import, C, boosting international trade, D, none of the above. So friends, obviously B can't be correct. Answer is A, that is solution is A. NIRVIC scheme is basically the Export Credit Guarantee Corporation of India is optimistic that the NIRVIC scheme announced by the Union government will give a fillip to export lending and insurance cover for export credit. So this scheme was launched to ease the lending process and enhance loan availability for exporters. So insurance cover granted will cover up to 90% of the principal and interest. So more details you can check by pausing the video. Now let's move on to the next question. Next is, Unnat Bharat Abhiyan is implemented by which ministry? A, Ministry of Home Affairs, B, Ministry of Human Resource Development, C, Prime Minister Office, D, none of the above. So friends, the answer is B, that is Ministry of Human Resource Development. Unnat Bharat Abhiyan was launched with an aim to connect institutions of higher education, including IITs, NITs, and Indian Institutes of Science and Education, Science Education and Research, with local communities to address the development challenges that through appropriate technologies. So this is more of a kind of a participatory system, in which the system that is followed is more of a practical nature. The technology that is to be researched about is more of a concern with the day-to-day. By solving of day-to-day challenges that the rural India faces, local communities face. It is not just rural India but local communities. So it is to enable higher educational institutions to work with people of rural India and identifying the development challenges and evolving appropriate solutions for accelerating sustainable growth. So it also aims to create a virtuous cycle between society and an inclusive academic system by providing knowledge and practices for emerging professions and to upgrade the capabilities of both the public and the private sectors in responding to the development needs of rural India. So twofold objectives are there: building institutional capacity in institutes of higher education and research and training relevant to the needs of rural India, and providing rural India with professional resource support from institutes of higher education, especially those which have acquired academic excellence in the field of science, engineering, technology and management. Now let's move on to the next question. Next is, arrange the following atomic power stations from south to north. A, Kundankulam atomic power station, second Narora atomic power station, third Kayagar atomic power station, fourth Kakrapara atomic power station. So friends, the answer is C, that is 1, 3, 4, 2. So Narora is basically this has been due to from south to north. Yeah, we have to arrange from south to north. So obviously southernmost is southernmost Answer is C. So yeah, Kundankulam Atomic Power Station, that is in Tamil Nadu, that will come at first level, and Narora is basically in your UP. So Kaga Atomic Power Station and then Kakrapara Atomic Power Station is also there. So you can check it. Now let's move on to the next question is IBA 100 CNE news is related to first Indian Brain Atlas, second regional organization C, exoplanet, Indian of the above. So friends, answer is A, that is first Indian Brain Atlas. So IIT Hyderabad creates the first Indian Brain Atlas. So it is named IBA 100. So other brain atlases include Chinese, Korean and Caucasian. So this is first digital human brain atlas was created by the Montreal Neurological Institute. So facts is that atlas reveals that Indian brain is smaller in height, width and volume. So Indian brain is comparatively to the western and eastern population, our brain is smaller and in height, width and volume, but it is not necessarily that we have lesser skills than western people. We have come out of the yoke of colonialism, and we are in fact there are many problems and challenges that India faces, but 70 years of our journey is also there is, if everything is not to be proud of, then at least some of the things are there in which we can feel proud. Our public institutions are doing very good, and so far as science and technology is concerned, for example ISRO, then obviously challenges are there, but then we can't deny our achievements as well. So this study will help in the early diagnosis of brain diseases like Alzheimer's. So Indian specific brain atlas was created by using MRI scans of 50 individuals of different genders. So this is all about, friends, today's discussion of daily MCQs, daily current affair MCQs. So if you like this discussion, if you like the video, then do ensure that you like it, share it with your friends. And lastly, friends, this is our Telegram channel, the link of which is shown on your screen. So this Telegram channel, you can join this Telegram channel, because here on this Telegram channel we have more than 14,000 subscribers that follow us. So you can be part of them and can have access to various resources that we share on this Telegram channel for the purpose of CSE preparation. And also this is our website, that is www.achieveias.co.in, and this is a YouTube channel, mail is this and contact number is this. If you have any queries, you can contact us at achieveias21@gmail.com. or you can also contact us at 89689-20720. So friends, all these details are also provided in the description box, so do ensure that you check the description box. So this is all about today's video. Thank you, have a very nice day ahead.